Literally at this point, all you have to do is ask, and I'll probably make a video about it. If you're a beginner to intermediate artist, chances are you're kind of sick of photo studies. It's that same old rut of Googling the perfect image, then copying it down pixel for pixel, then being happy that you could copy and do the reference justice, but also wishing you had a bit more originality as an artist. And then, of course, the imposter syndrome kicks in, where you feel like you can never come up with anything original, and you're basically just a glorified photocopier. At least that's what my imposter syndrome used to say to me. But I have good news. Your photocopier phase is just that. It's a phase. Today's video was requested by one of our Discord server members, Ruffles Thompson, who asked if I could make a video on how you can go beyond just doing photo studies and start looking at making some original paintings from your imagination. Now, this is personally one of the biggest, most recent hurdles that I've had to face in my art journey as such. So I'm more than happy to share with you some tips on how you can get started shifting away from just copying a reference photo and stepping into finding your own style and creating your own original paintings. And you guys, when I started to dive into this topic, I realized that there was just no way I could fit all of this information into one video because there's just way too much that I want to share with you. And it's not really that easy to just instantly switch from photo studies to original paintings. So this is gonna be a two-parter. Today, I'm gonna show you how you can supercharge your photo studies as a primer slash prep session for next week's video, where we'll start looking at how you can actually create original paintings from scratch. As always, if you enjoyed this video and find it helpful, then please do let me know by giving it a big thumbs up and leaving a comment below. Hit that subscribe button and notification bell so you don't miss part two when it drops next week. And if you'd like to support this channel and grab some even more exclusive content every single week, come check out my Patreon. The link is in the video description. And now let's dive in. Before we dive in, I just quickly want to say happy Pride Month, you guys. I hope wherever you are, whoever you identify as, that you are surrounded by unconditional love and support. And I know these are some trying times for humanity as a whole, and especially for some members of the LGBTQ community. But if you need to hear this today, I see you, I love you, and I am so, so proud of you. And I promise you the world is a much better place now that you're in it. So thank you for existing. Happy Pride Month. All right, let's get into the video. So first things first, here's what you're gonna need today. Your sketchbook and or your painting software and access to the interwebs, both of which you already have. One more thing I highly recommend getting is this software called PureRef. This is not sponsored, I wish, but PureRef is basically a very simple window where you can drag and drop images onto. This works especially well if you get references off Pinterest or ArtStation. You just literally drag and drop them into the PureRef window. It has an always on top mode, which I always have on, so the window doesn't disappear behind my Photoshop window. And personally, I keep this window open on my second monitor just so you guys can see the entire screen on my first monitor when I'm painting. But for today, I'm gonna keep it on the painting window just so you can see what's going on PureRef. And before we even get to the techniques, I would say step zero is to start with a super rough idea of what you're trying to paint. If you're out of ideas, you can do what I did for today's video and use a random character profile generator. I'll link you to the one I use below, and it will just spit out a random character for you to paint or write or do whatever. Mine is a 29-year-old anthropologist named Liz Richards, who lost her left leg when she was 11, is very shady about her past, and is apparently a crazy cat lady. No, like literally, she built like a cat. So, with this delightful idea in mind, I'm just putting down a super rough character sketch down on my custom character design template. If you don't have one or you don't want to create one yourself, you could find a character mannequin or template thing online and start sketching out your character on one of those. Now that we have a rough idea of what we're looking for, finding photos to study from will be a million times easier because you're going to search for very specific references. So let's get into these three techniques. When it comes to choosing references, the biggest roadblock is always that you're looking for that one perfect reference that has everything you need. Sadly, there aren't any psychic stock photographers out there who will have shot the exact scene you'd like to copy off of, but I personally think that's a good thing because your options are not limited to an individual photo. No, what we're gonna do today is break down our end goal into pieces and look for references for these individual pieces. And in our drawing, we're gonna basically collage these pieces together and create a custom sketch. I always start with a bunch of references for the pose and anatomy. With Liz over here, I want something that says mean and shady, but also feline and graceful. So I'm gonna go for a pretty simple standing pose where she's perfectly balanced despite having one prosthetic leg, and she's holding a skull because she's an anthropologist. One extra tip I want to give you here is to not just look for photographs, but also grab some actual art that you think might be a good reference. Personally, I like to grab a ton of character art, even if it doesn't fit my sketch, just to use as lighting and color references. Artists have the ability to take the real world around you and drive up its aesthetic value and make it more visually appealing in a way direct photographers cannot do. Having a couple of these paintings on your reference window will help you keep an open mind and look at areas of enhancement within your painting. I hope that made sense, but yeah, grab a whole bunch of references and think of ways in which you can put together elements from each of them to fit into your sketch. If you really want to take this a step further and really solidify all the elements in your scene and make them believable, you should definitely look for multiple reference photos or paintings for each element in your scene. Here, for instance, I've got at least 5 different references for the skull in various lighting and color setups, just so when I paint the skull into this piece, I know what I'm doing. I don't paint skulls often at all, and so I'd like to make sure that I have enough understanding of it in terms of 3D, and when I'm rendering it, it's not just a flat object, but rather I understand what its form would look like in this particular angle and lighting. You can do this with costume elements such as fabric and armor, weapon elements like blades and rifles, and even with anatomy, especially features on the face. This is actually a great way to avoid same face syndrome, which is when all your characters come out looking identical. Just grab a bunch of face references of people who look very different to each other, then pick a feature from each face and collage together a new face from it. It might seem like a lot of work to have like 5 references for one single element in a painting, but I want you to remember that you're not just doing this for one painting. When you work with a bunch of references for a single object, you're not just doing a compare and contrast and picking which one vaguely fits into your scene. What you're doing is basically building a 3-dimensional model of it in your mind. It's like that scene in Ocean's 8 where Helena Bonham Carter is scanning the necklace for Rihanna and that machine is trying to build a 3D model of it from every angle. It's not about making one copy of it, that scan can then be used to make a million other necklaces just like that one. Similarly, when you're learning the form and dimensions of an element in your study, you're also storing the blueprint of it in your memory, so later on it's easier for you to draw that same element without needing as many references. It's extra steps now, but your future self will thank you when you're going into blank canvases and conjuring up paintings out of thin air. You know how I said don't just use photo references, but also use other people's paintings as reference? This is where that idea really shines, because when we have our sketch and basic colors and values down and are about 70% done with the painting, we're gonna look at some references on how other amazing artists who know what they're doing have rendered specific materials. I've noticed that it's way easier for me to figure out how to render certain materials by looking at other art of those materials rather than photo reference. I guess other art shows you how to basically create the illusion of a specific material rather than photos, which basically only give you literal pixels. What I'm trying to say is, let's say we're texturing this fabric. Looking at a photo gives me no clue about how to render this texture without literally painting every stitch and weave in the fabric. When I look at someone else's render of this fabric, however, I start to recognize and back engineer some of their steps. So I'm able to recognize the strokes of a texture brush, or I can see the edges of a custom selection that has been painted into. And if I'm really lucky, I might be able to figure out how the placement of certain highlights and shadows create the illusion of a certain type of fabric. Some great materials that I almost always use art references and not photo references for are leather, water, rock and mountains, clouds, metal, hair, and basically anything that is made of loads of tiny moving parts. Like with hair, for instance, a good stock photo will capture most visible individual strands of hair. But if I'm trying to paint that hair, it would take literally forever to render each strand, and the result would likely be really messy and entirely too detailed. If I rendered hair based off another artist's rendering style for hair, however, not only does it take way less time, it also helps me paint the hair in such a way that it doesn't clash with the level of detail in the main focus of the painting, which for me here is her face. So my final tip about supercharging your photo studies is to look for painted references for materials to help you render your own materials a lot better. And next week, we're going to take a look at creating some original paintings that don't directly require photo references. I hope you've enjoyed this video and found it helpful. And if you have, then please do let me know by giving it a big thumbs up and leaving a comment below. Hit that subscribe button and notification bell so you know when part two of this video drops next week. If there are any specific video requests you'd like to see on this channel in the future, I'm now taking most video requests in my Discord server, apart from style study requests, which still come from the comments. But if you have any other video requests, it just makes it easier for me to have a separate channel on the Discord server so that all of the requests are in one place and they don't get lost in the source. So if you have any very urgent video requests you'd like to see on this channel, come join the Discord. The link is in the video description and there's a specific channel for video requests. And with all of that said, thank you so much for hanging out with me today. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Check out some more videos up here and I'll see you next week with part two. Bye.